Hello, friends, and thank you for worshiping with us again online. We are looking forward to when we can meet again in person. I have had some conversations, continue to have conversations with church members and leaders in the church, and we have decided that we will continue to meet online through August. I have been talking to other churches. I'm watching the positivity rates for Delaware County and specifically how those positivity rates are going to be affected by the reopening of Ball State and local schools. In the meantime, we are looking at ways in which we can be together in safe ways. So keep your eyes open, watch our Facebook page and our website, and check your email for some pop-up events. We're looking at maybe having some pop-up church, pop-up gatherings, either in person safely or online. So even while things are unpredictable, odd, crazy, unprecedented, the church is still being attentive to our mission and ways in which we continue being the church. There are several studies coming up that are on Zoom. And so please check your bulletin, your online bulletin, check your announcements. There are too many to outline right now, which makes my heart happy. And if you are uncomfortable in any way using Zoom, if it sounds foreign to you, please talk to Nicole Call, our communications director, and she can walk you through it. It's really quite easy once you get the hang of it. And you can see each other and you can talk to each other. It's the next best thing to being together. We are gathering items still for Westview Elementary. So please check your announcements and your online bulletin for the specific items that the school needs. I also want to remind you that the sanctuary and the chapel are always open on Wednesdays and Thursdays from 10 to noon during our office hours. So if you're just longing to spend some time in that sacred space to pray or meditate, please feel free to come in from 10 to noon on Wednesdays and Thursdays. This morning we gather from wherever we are. I'm in my office again this morning to worship God. So hear now this call to worship as we turn our hearts toward the Lord our God. God will speak peace to God's people, to God's faithful, to those who turn their hearts toward God. So let us worship our God in purity of heart. Let us sing praise to the Lord God Almighty.
Praise to the Lord, we are. Hello, my friends, and welcome to our children's message. I'm so glad that you joined us again today. You're in your living rooms or your family rooms or wherever you're gathered. It's just good to be together, right? So I really like rhymey books. You know that, don't you? And I really, really like Dr. Seuss books. And you know why? Because they rhyme. But I came upon a new Dr. Seuss book that I had not heard of before. It's called, Would You Rather Be a Bullfrog? Hadn't thought about that. Have you heard of it? No, me neither. But the book starts out, Would You Rather Be a Dog or a Cat? It's time for you to think about important things like that. Now, how many of you would rather be a dog?
You want to be a dog?
Yeah, you get to run around, chase things, bring back. How about a cat? You want to be a cat? You get to take lots of naps when you're a cat. So I don't know, but you have the choice, right? In this Dr. Seuss book, you get to pick between a dog or a cat. And there are lots of other silly choices that you get to make too. But it's pretty fun. It's good to have choices, right? Yeah. Well, Dr. Seuss is giving us the opportunity to make lots of them. Now, in our Bible lesson today, we are looking at another letter from Paul, right? Paul wrote lots of letters, and he wrote them to encourage early Christians, to give instructions. He taught them about Jesus, and we find those letters in the New Testament, right after Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, and then we go into the letters from Paul. And the first letter is to the people in Rome, the capital of Italy. And it's called the Romans, right? So this is to the early Christians in Rome. Here it is. Yeah. Now these people are struggling. They're struggling with their identity. And Paul doesn't give them the choices that Dr. Seuss gives to us. No, Paul reminds them of what it means to be a Christian. He tells them, Christians are not selfish. Christians instead, what do? We share. We share the things that we have with people who don't. Right? You outgrow your clothing, you share them with someone else. You have an extra winter coat, you share it with someone else. We share food with people who don't have enough food, like the crops that we're growing in our mission garden or the groceries that we collect to take to Covenant Partners. All those ways we share because we are not selfish. Christians are not selfish. And Paul tells the people in Rome, Christians are not self-centered. No, we are Christ-centered. And when we are not self-centered, we're thinking about other people. We're thinking about people who are marginalized, people who are bullied because they look different, they talk different, they do different things, or maybe they are lonely. And so we call them, we send a letter, or a picture, right? These are all the things that we can do because we are not self-centered. Christians are not self-centered, Paul tells us. So, Paul goes so far as to tell the people in Romans, in the letter to the Romans, he says that selfishness is hostile to God and self-centeredness is not pleasing to God. As followers of Jesus, we want to please God, and so we share, and so we think and care for others, not for ourselves. So I can just imagine Paul telling those people in Rome, he may have said, would you rather be a Christian or a gnat? It is time for you to think about important things like that. So let's do that this week, shall we? Let's have a word of prayer. Loving God, we thank you for reminding us that we as Christians are called to not be selfish, to not be self-centered, to share what we have, to care for all God's children. Help us to do that today and every day. Amen. My friends, put your hands up to the screen. Yay, to your screens, because you are a blessing. Be well. Bye-bye.
Please join me in prayer. Living God, help us so to hear your holy word that we may truly understand. That understanding we may believe. And believing we may follow in all faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and glory in all that we do. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The scripture reading today comes from Romans 8, verses 1 through 11. So now there isn't any condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. God has done what was impossible for the law, since it was weak because of selfishness. God condemned sin in the body by sending his own Son to deal with sin in the same body as humans, who are controlled by sin. He did this so that the righteous requirements of the law might be fulfilled in us. Now, the way we live is based on the Spirit, not based on selfishness. People whose lives are based on selfishness think about selfish things, but people whose lives are based on the Spirit think about things that are related to the Spirit. The attitude that comes from selfishness leads to death, but the attitude that comes from the Spirit leads to life and peace. So the attitude that comes from selfishness is hostile to God. It doesn't submit to God's law because it can't. People who are self-centered aren't able to please God. But you aren't self-centered. Instead, you are in the Spirit, if in fact God's Spirit lives in you. If anyone doesn't have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Him. If Christ is in you, the Spirit is your life because of God's righteousness. But the body is dead because of sin. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your human bodies also through his Spirit that lives in you. The Word of God from the people of God.
Just one.
we're going to take a few weeks to look at another one of the Apostle Paul's letters. This letter was written to the Romans. It was written to people he had never met, but he had heard of their faith, and he wanted to encourage them. These people were living in uncertain, perilous times. The world they were living in was changing. The church was diverse. It was now open to Jew and Gentile alike. This was new to them, and it created new stresses and discomfort. So the Apostle Paul is writing to bring words of hope and encouragement as these people live into a new normal. In this series, we're going to be looking at some of the passages from the letter to the church at Rome to see how God sustains us even in the midst of brokenness, helping us to find wholeness and healing and unity even as we face crisis and uncertainty. I don't think it would surprise any of us to hear me say that we are living in a broken world. There is evidence of that all around us. We can drive downtown and we can see the homeless walking about. We can go to the soup kitchen or Covenant Partners or any one of the ministries and missions in Muncie and see evidence of a broken world. But we can see evidence of a broken world on any side of town in any neighborhood. The violence in our society is on the front pages of our newspaper, if you still read a hard copy, or on your screen of your computer and devices as we look at the headlines of the day. We are living in the midst of a global pandemic that none of us have ever lived through before. There are racial and ethnic divides. There are political divides. There is strife and confusion and fear and division. All of these are evidence of a broken world. In chapter 7 and 8 of Romans, Paul writes a lot about sin. And at the end of chapter 7, Paul writes about his own struggle. Paul, like us, wants to do good, and then sometimes he doesn't. And then there's other times when he doesn't want to sin, but he still does. And so he cries out, "Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of sin?" But friends, this isn't a cry of defeat. It isn't saying, "Oh, well, that's just the way it is." No, because Paul responds to his own question by saying, "Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord." Now remember, there are no chapter divisions in a letter. So Paul goes right from that discussion in chapter 7 to verse 1 of chapter 8, saying, "So now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because we live now under a new law. We're no longer living under the old law of rules and regulations. Now we are living under the new covenant in Christ. We are living under a new law, the law of the Spirit of life." So just as Jesus was the answer to who can deliver us from lives of sin and death, Jesus is the one who ushers in the new law of life. Paul tells the church at Rome that God sent Jesus into the sinful world to live in flesh and blood, just like us, just like other human beings, in order to take sin out of the world. Now, obviously, because we see it in the headlines, there is still obviously a lot of sin in the world. We see it every day, and we hear about it every day. But on the other hand, we know that the Spirit of Christ is also in the world. We know that while we don't always make the right choices, just as Paul struggled, we also know that we're not condemned because the law of life is at work in us. The key is choosing to live according to that law of life. So Paul goes on in his letter and he says, the way that we live now isn't based on selfishness, but it's based on the Spirit of God. If we're basing our lives on sinful selfishness, if we're thinking about selfish, sinful things, that's living according to the flesh. But if our lives and our thoughts are based on the Spirit, then we think about the things that are related to the Spirit. That is, we meditate on, we dwell, we spend our time throughout our day thinking about things that bring life. Those who live according to the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus don't think about selfish things, sinful things. They set their minds upon things that bring life, but not just to themselves, but things that bring life to others. Our bodies and our minds are inseparable. Our thoughts affect our bodies. Today's sermon is called Broken Spirits, Broken Bodies. Science is discovering more and more about this every day, about how our minds and our spirits are connected to our bodies. But we don't have to be a scientist to know this. We know that when we are stressed out, we get a headache. Maybe our heart races, our blood pressure goes up. Broken spirits lead to broken bodies. Our bodies are affected by our mental and spiritual condition. And we know that Jesus is the healer. The Spirit of Jesus, the Spirit of life, lives in us. So therefore, our life can flourish as we submit our minds and our hearts to God's Spirit, to God's Word, instead of our own selfish desires. But friends, it isn't just our own physical bodies and lives that are affected by sin. The body of the human family is affected by sin and selfishness. Personal and societal sins go by some of the same names: greed, malice, hatred, division, prejudice. These are the ways in which our individual spirits and souls are broken, but they're also ways in which the spirit of our society are broken by selfishness and sin. All of this makes for a sick and broken world. Friends, our sin is killing us. Black bodies and brown bodies are in particular danger. In some parts of the world, more than others, female bodies are living in peril. In some parts of the world, bodies of particular religious beliefs, Christians, for instance, are living in peril. Paul writes that the mindset that leads to death focuses on fleshly, sinful, selfish things, not the well-being of others. This is what we are seeing in our world today. The ways of the world are the ways of death. Death of hope, death of justice, death of peace. But life in the Spirit is liberating us from fear and hatred, prejudice, greed, malice. Life in the Spirit of Christ is healing, and it's liberating and life-giving. That's what we need today. That's what our world needs today. So when we commit ourselves to live according to the spirit of life that is in Christ Jesus, we commit ourselves to focusing our mind on the things of the Spirit. We can go to Galatians and look at the fruit of the Spirit. But we know that the things of the Spirit are love, are full of hope. They're full of compassion and kindness and unity. When we focus our minds on these things, when we set our minds on things above and not things of the world, our broken spirits can be healed. And as our broken spirits are healed, we can become those ambassadors we talked about last week that empower us to be part of the healing of our broken world. I pray that it may be so for me, for you, for those in our church and our community, that we can be part of healing broken spirits and broken bodies. Amen. Please pray with me. As summer days move rapidly toward the busyness of autumn, our attention is drawn forward. God, you know there are so many things looming on our horizons. There is so much uncertainty and brokenness in us and in our world. Be with us, loving God. Remind us to set our minds upon Jesus and the things that are good and holy and just. Help us keep the needs of others in our hearts and mind. Needs for healing, for comfort, for friendship. Help us to reach out to them and to offer our gifts and service in your name. As you have loved and healed us, we ask for your healing mercies to be upon those who are upon our hearts today. We ask you also for guidance and patience with us as we go forward through these last weeks of summer, confident in Jesus' love for us. We pray the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to thank you again for your faithfulness through these difficult and uncertain days. Because of your faithfulness and giving, seeing that giving is a spiritual act of worship, you all have remained faithful, and we have remained strong financially during this season of pandemic. I want to remind you that you can continue to mail in your checks. You can make arrangements with your financial institution for online giving, or you can go to our website and give there. It's easy and it's safe and secure. So join me now in this prayer of thanksgiving for our offering. We look to you, O God, to be present in our communities and in our world. Continue to show us how we at College Avenue can be part of your work of healing this broken world. Teach us how we can grow in faith and become more like Jesus. We ask, Lord, that you would also bless the works of our hands. Bless all that we offer today, not only in what we give of our money, but our gifts of time and talent as well. Pour out your blessing upon these gifts so healing can come to this broken world. In Jesus' name, amen. Receive now this benediction. You have been embraced by the love of God. You have been empowered by the Holy Spirit. And you have been blessed by Jesus, the reconciler of the world, to go into this world and offer healing and hope. Go in the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.